today are just stretched in so many ways, so many pressures, and anyone that's taken their kids to Disneyland is supposed to be the happiest place on earth, and for the parents, sometimes it's not the happiest place on earth, and paying $10 for a peanut butter jelly sandwich at lunchtime, and going on rides all day, and getting dizzy, and sometimes life itself can just feel kind of dizzy and really expensive and costly, and feel like you're running around with your head chopped off sometimes, and that's all the stresses and pressure of the family is just can be intense. I went to the One Hope prayer time this week, and Lisa Prayo, I think, is going to maybe be our prayer coordinator, 24-hour prayer coordinator. We have the third Saturday each month, and we pray for 24 hours, and it's just been a great experience, and we've seen all kinds of differences made in our city. And who shared at this week at the One Hope meeting was John Reese, who is the Eugene City Manager, and he just shared how many prayers have been answered around the city of Eugene, big things that he's praying for, and he's leading a group of government officials that are Christians that are letting the churches know how we can pray for our city and the government and things. And just one answered prayer after another was just great to hear, and God's provision. Recently, this homeless camp on 99, he said normally there's all this turmoil when they move it to a safer place or safer location, but they prayed leading up to that, and there was a smooth transition to a safer place that's in-house by St. Vinny's, part of the Christian community that's helping those people get more homes. And but some of the things he said about the family were striking. I just didn't know about the family situations in our area, but maybe some of these stats or things will help you out in kind of understanding this area, the city we live in, a little bit more. One, you may not know that right now there's 1,500 kids, students under 18, 1,500 that are considered homeless here in the Eugene Springfield area. And so that's enough to, that's a full, one of our large, that'd be enough to populate one of our larger high schools. Of those 1,500, 300, about 300 of them are on their own. They're not with adults that are homeless. They are homeless teens or middle school students. And they're just, what they're just couch surfing. They're finding a friend or a home, somebody that will let them just crash on their couch and take their backpack with them and go to school and things. But 1,500 was striking to me. And so it's great how the Christian community is rallying around, not in just foster care and helping in those ways, but the Christian community right now is the drive right now behind lower income housing, affordable housing. I don't know if you know this stat, but Eugene is second only to Seattle, Washington in proportion of wages to cost of housing, and the difference or the big gap there. Like, we're the second most expensive place to live comparative to how much wages are coming in versus how much the cost of expensive housing is. Second in the nation in the worst places to live as far as wages to housing. And 44% of our community, if you talk about just the stress that might be on families and things, 44% of our community doesn't have anything saved. They're definitely living from paycheck to paycheck, to where even a $400 emergency, such an extra dental bill or an electricity bill that was higher than normal, or any kind of sudden emergency, 44% of our community, they will begin juggling to figure out what things bills are not going to pay in order to make things work. And I thought, man, there is some stresses and pressure on the families that are unique to the community that we live in, right in Eugene. And there's some discussion amongst the Christian community trying to help inform the government and things as to why our community is like that, why we're unique in that way, why we're so high on the scale of needing more intervention to help people just make ends meet. And so maybe you have your own theories and things, but that's where we're at. And so we want to talk about, though, God's design for the family and why the family exists. And we've been doing this series on foundations for fellowship, and we know that the home, the marriages, the home, how that goes, so goes the church, and how the churches go, so goes the nation, and the communities is only as strong as the people of faith in that area, and the family is an important part of that. Family, like marriage, is also reflective of God's relationship with his church. Several times in Scripture, his church is called his household, the family of God. We learn from Scriptures that indeed the Jewish people are special and that God chose to reveal his plan to these people, this people group. But Jesus came as a Jew living amongst the Jews. But Scripture goes on to share how God's plan of redemption is really for everybody, that he loves the whole world. And he says in John 1:12, "Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to be called the children of God." And so he wants to bring us all into his family. Not just the Jews, but also the Gentiles alike, who he's called and to come and be part of his family. For Gentiles, in Romans 11, I believe, it talks about the opportunity specifically to be grafted in, to be adopted into God's chosen family by receiving his son into our lives. And so we're all ultimately made for family. And God's family is one based on unconditional love. Even though we've been adopted, there's nothing we could do that God could give up on us or kick us out of being part of his family. I was reading about David Prince. He said he knows a family who adopted an older child from unspeakable horrific orphanage in another country. And when they brought her home, one of the things they told her was that she was expected to clean her room every day to sort of kind of give her ownership into the home and things. And when she heard about that responsibility, though, she fixated on it and saw it as a way she would earn her family's love. In other words, she isolated the responsibility and applied it to her existing frame of thinking that was shaped by life in the orphanage. Thus, every morning when her parents came in her room, it was immaculate, and she would sit on the bed and say, "My room is clean. Can I stay? Do you still love me?" And her words would break her parents' hearts. Eventually, the girl learned to hear her parents' words as their unconditionally beloved child who would never be forsaken, not as a visitor trying to earn her place in the family, but after she knew that she was an inseparable part of the family story, even correction and discipline did not cause her to question her family's love for her anymore. And she began to understand the correction and discipline to be part of what it meant to be in the family. And so we are part of the Lord's family, and he may correct us, we may be rebuked, but we are in his family, those who have received him into our lives. We've been adopted into his family and given the right to be called the very children of God. And so we're going to look at how God has designed the family, and I think it's interesting that so many of the characteristics that describe our wonderful God and his wonderful family is also the way he desires our earthly families to be. So I'm going to talk about two amazing traits God has designed for successful families today. And in a couple weeks, after we have a guest speaker next week, but after that, finish kind of this idea on the family and what God's design for it is. And so here's the first amazing trait that I make for amazing families that are like the family of God. Amazing family trait number one is that amazing families are playful. Might seem kind of simplistic and things, but I think this is the first common denominator of great families. They know how to play. They know how to have fun. They know how to enjoy life together. This is a missing ingredient, I believe, in so many families today. Today, families are often too busy. They're too tired. They're negative. They're too worn out. They're way too serious. They take themselves too serious. And I think, who wants to come home from school to that? Family should be fun. The average family is all work and no play. It's just getting to the next appointment, doing the next deal, getting the next thing done, getting the next chore done. But amazing families know the importance of having fun together. The importance to remember our families are not boot camps. Our families are not, our parents are not drill sergeants, part of the boot camps. Family is not a business. Parents are not CEOs. Families are not a laboratory experiment or a scientific research project where we're trying to develop the most perfect kid. Because there's no perfect kids and there's no perfect families. Families are not a business, but a work of art, a treasure, something to work on and play in and enjoy. So many of us know the Bible says we need to work. We need to work hard. There's a place in Proverbs that says, if we're lazy, then we shouldn't eat. So So we're usually aware of, yeah, we need to work. We need to encourage people to work and work hard. But how often do you think the Bible is telling you you should have fun in this life? Does that message get communicated? That you should enjoy this life, that family should be a great part of that joy and fun in life. I remember growing up as a kid going on a family road trip. We went on lots of family road trips because there were six of us, so it was harder to get plane tickets for everybody. But we went on a lot of road trips, and I think it was so much fun putting the seats down in the station wagon so we could have our sleeping bags, and Mom and Dad would drive, and we would just sleep sometimes and arrive places. Other times, we would be sitting up, and we would play great games like the license plate game. You know, you guys probably all done that. How many played Password? You know, we had six of us, so it was perfect. But Password's 2x2, and we had front seat, the back seat, and we'd give clues and try and play these competitive games as we were on our way. Kind of those trips, we go all the way to Colorado Springs in our Gale station wagon, you know, playing these fun games and spotting the beautiful scenery and things and growing as a family. It inspired our Mount Rushmore trip just a couple summers ago that the Cons let us use their motor home, and we went across the country to see Mount Rushmore. And I still remember after the lighting ceremony of the mountain, you know, there's all kinds of traffic getting out of the parking lot, and we met to this motor home, and kids got their jammies on, and we began to play card games and had Rocky Road ice cream and thought, wow, there's no need to fight the traffic. We got our home right here in the parking lot with us. And it's just great joy being together and looking. Kids look forward to that time together like sometimes like you wouldn't believe. Because just remember what it's like to being a kid. I remember my dad when he'd say, we're going on a backpacking trip. I remember the excitement of loading up the car with all this adventure gear. You know, pocket knives and flashlights and, you know, all the things we're going to need to cut a sharp stick and roast a marshmallow in, or just simply sit this stick in the fire and let the end smoke and wave it around for hours. You know, as a kid, that was just so much fun, right? You just put the sticks in the fire and let it smoke, and you say you're getting rid of the mosquitoes and things. You're actually doing something worthwhile. But really, this is all for fun. It was just an outing that Dad would do us for simply the reason of enjoyment and having fun together. I guess one trip, we were going backpacking, and my brother couldn't go because he was starting to get the teenage years, and he had daily doubles in football getting towards the end of summer. I said, Dad, can we go on a backpacking trip? He goes, you want to go just with me, just your dad? And I'm like, yeah. And so just the two of us went to one of our favorite places, Tennis Lakes, and we went up there and just walked around and enjoyed the time together. But we thought, well, you get creative when you're just by yourself in the woods, just a couple, two of you, after swimming in the lake, after jumping on rocks and jumping in the lake and things. And what else do you do? Well, I thought, Dad, you know, I don't know how to play poker. And then he said, whoa, man, son, you know, it's not the most fun game in the world. People play it because of the excitement of winning something, winning cash and things. And after talking about the senselessness of gambling, and first he agreed to teach me how to play poker with some cards. But we didn't have money or chips or anything, but we had granola bars and fruit roll-ups. And so we begin to play with fruit roll-ups and granola bars being sort of our chips to bet on or gamble on. And I became pretty good. I became pretty good in the midst of the game. And halfway through it, most of the bars and fruit roll-ups are with me, and Dad's got a few of them left. And suddenly he begins to rip open his granola bars and fruit roll-ups and just eating them and saying, I'm going to eat these up while I still have them. You know, a good lesson about what you could lose by gambling and things. But it was just fun. And it was no other reason but just enjoyment and getting to know my dad better. My dad spending time with me for no other reason but having fun. At Christmas Eve this year, it was just a great example of the greater extended family and what our parents kind of passed on to us as kids and things. You know, we got together for first going around and telling how God has made us special for ministry. Mom kind of had us do that. Dad reads through the Christmas story. And then Teresa breaks into these games afterwards, after the kids got their traditional jammies on, that they got new jammies each year. Then we went to the other room and played these games called Minute to Win It. And it was the adults against the kids, and it was just pandemonium. It was one game after another, and the kids ended up winning the adults. They all got free gift cards. The losers didn't get anything. But it was really, really fun. I thought, man, it's great being part of a family and having a mom and sisters and dads that plan a program for you to take part in around Christmas time, Christmas Eve, that we're going to have some real fun. And the fun doesn't involve any vice. There's no need to have any kind of vice or alcohol or anything. It was just a celebration of good fun, and it felt just fabulous to be a part. Something God has created for us. He designed the family. I remember right after the games, Dad, he's the grandpa to all the kids. He turned on his little, got lights on it, and it's like a jukebox with with a disco ball, and Megan begins just to dance. And we just enjoyed taking in Megan being a ham and dancing in front of us and just loving those kinds of things. And I think, wow, family is something God has made that is good. It is good. A lot of times it gets stressed, sometimes even fractured, but God's design was it to be enjoyable. The Bible speaks through Solomon, the most successful, wisest man to live in man's wisdom, had a large family, and he says this, which the Bible says, enjoying life is good. Nothing guilty for us about enjoying life. Ecclesiastes 8:15 says, so I commend the enjoyment of life. So I commend the enjoyment of life, because there is nothing better for a person under the sun than to eat and drink and be glad. Then joy will accompany them in their toil all the days of life God has given them under the sun. Did you know it's okay for you and even ordained for you to enjoy life? That God, when he looked at his creation and all the things he made for you, he said, man, this is good. This is good for you to enjoy life. God actually endorses or puts a stamp of approval for enjoying your spouse. So I think, well, we just got married so we could have kids and be fruitful and multiply and be under God's direction and work hard and learn some skills and contribute to society. But did you know you're supposed to enjoy your spouse? Sometimes I think, well, I'm just supposed to survive my spouse. I'm just supposed to get through life and stay married because it's an institution and it's good and God made it. But did you know you're actually supposed to enjoy it? Not tolerate it, not just get through, but enjoy. Be something that brings a smile to your face, something that encourages you. We've already talked about marriage and God's reason for it the last 2 weeks, so we won't say much here, except it's a relationship that is designed by God for your and my enjoyment. Ecclesiastes 9:9-10 says, enjoy life with your wife, whom you love, all the days of this meaningless life that God has given you under the sun, all your meaningless days, for this is your lot in life. And in your toilsome labor under the sun, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. For in the realm of the dead, where you are going, there is neither working nor planning nor knowledge nor wisdom. Well, certainly these are some Old Testament verses, and the understanding that they had at this time, and the people are one day going to pass from this planet, and you won't be able to enjoy your spouse, you won't be able to work or toil anymore. But while you're here, while you've got this time, enjoy the relationships that God has been able to help put into your life. I remember when Kelly and I were first dating, and we would walk across the quad of the college campus that we were in. There was sidewalks in the middle of grass fields on each side. You'd walk on a sidewalk, then turn, make a walk. We had this game while we were dating to try and knock the other person off the sidewalk into the grass. And it was just about getting a lower center of gravity. I was amazed how strong Kelly was to get lower than me and knock me. Sometimes she surprised me because the game was always on the sidewalk. And sometimes she would just get the lower center of gravity and shove me off, and I'd go flying. And then I would just try and push her buttons and get a reaction and antagonize her. And she said once, since then, I think our marriage will last as long as I keep reacting to how irritating and annoying you are. And I said, you know, you're probably right. We like to play these. Why do we play these games? Why? Because it's fun. We like to poke fun at each other. We like to enjoy. We like to give each other a hard time sometimes. We like to find ways to play little games in life. Why do we play these little games? It's fun. I'm not the only one in our family. I called my brother one time, and Laura answered the phone. And I said, is Nate there? And she said, yes, I'll get him. And then she said, you know, I can't find him. He says, and he likes to play this game where he gets a phone call and he goes and hides. And it drives me nuts because I'm trying to find him for his phone call. I said, "Wow, Laura, that sounds kind of immature things." He said, "Yeah, immature, yeah." But he was having fun with that. Why does he do things like that? Well, because it's fun. It's a little hide and seek. Even adults are playing some of these hide and seek games. And how about your kids? Do you enjoy them playing with them? Grandkids? Do you know they're gifts from God? Some might be thinking they're gifts you'd like to exchange sometimes, but they're gifts. Psalms 127:3 says, "Children are a gift from the Lord. They are a reward from Him." Do you see your kids that way? Wow, these kids, yeah, the responsibility sometimes, wow, they're lots of work, wow, they're costly. But man, do you see them as, wow, these kids are gifts from God. Anybody ever play Candyland with their kids when they're young? Candyland's a game with little cards. Megan used to love playing that game. It doesn't help you or give you any advantage at all in the game if you have an education or older and more experience, because the game is all chance. It's just fun. You just draw cards and it puts you different places on the board. And I remember just playing with Megan, and Megan, even as a little tiny tyke, would say things sort of I described, like talking trash. "Hey, Dad, you're going down. I'm going to beat you." And I was like, "Okay, it's just Candyland, honey. I don't have any way of really just outsmarting you or anything." And she would win a lot of times. But she said, "You're going down," you know. She had all kinds of traits like that, just like her mom. Just kidding. Now she's playing memory games and beating the socks off us now. And memory game takes some skill. But she just loves playing games. And constantly in surveys of kids that are asked what do they most like to do with their parents and things, so many of them responded board games. We think, oh, kids don't want to, you know, want to do that with their parents and things. Yes, they do. Survey after survey, so they just want to play games with their parents and have this joyous occasions and unstructured time together. What I've noticed as I've been researching this is our young people are feeling much more stress and anxiety from previous generations. I see them not only stressed from loads of homework, but just some of the society ills that plague us. Some of you don't know, Willamette High School has been on lockdown 2 times in the last week. And I'd be texting Allie sometimes, "Hey, are you okay? Everything's all right?" "Oh, yeah, things are locked down. Suspicious person on campus, maybe carrying a weapon, and they're looking for them now." And thinking, wow, you know, this is just not something I ever thought about in high school. And so you can see maybe there's things in our society or culture that causing, you know, students more things to think about, more things they may worry about. Well, think how meaningful it is in today's culture for our kids to be able to have a refuge in their home where they can play games, where they have a safe place to fail, where there's no criticizing harshly, where they can find the opportunity to experience playful, unconditional love, where children are seen as precious gifts with no obligations to care about things. Well, this is part of God's design for His family. To be playful. To have fun together. To be a place in the world where you can still just be a kid. You know, I know after this thing happened at Cascade Middle School, I had a teacher call me and say, "Alan, could we maybe use your building or do something to bring kids and some counselors together and just allow kids just to be kids?" And so they ended up lining up something at Putters and let some of the kids that were just, there were some kids on my basketball team that I had to just counsel and encourage that were 2 rooms down from the front of Cascade Middle School where they heard the whole fight, where they heard the shots fired. And what do you think that does to a kid's? But what is even stronger, more powerful than that is having a home, again, that's a refuge, a place where fun happens, a place where they can let down, be themselves. Well, a second amazing trait that I'm going to cover today is amazing families encourage growth. Not just playfulness, but growth happens. A great thing to do in your family is develop a growth mindset in the home. Create an atmosphere of lifelong learning. You want to keep on growing till your last breath, right? We have a pastor's coaching network that meets here at Fairfield Baptist once a month. We keep on learning. We keep on reading together. And they say if you want to be a leader, you have to be a reader. You keep on growing. You don't want to stay stagnant. You want to grow in the Lord, in your relationship with the Lord. You want to grow in knowledge. You want to grow in wisdom. In our church, we not only offer worship services, but also Sunday morning and midweek Bible studies and fellowship opportunities. Why? Because people are gathering together to grow. We have a mission statement of sharing Christ, building up believers, and impacting the world. It's a growth mission. Well, in your homes, do you have a growth mission for your family? We don't know too much about Jesus' upbringing in the home of Mary and Joseph, but the Bible tells us he was growing in four key areas that human beings need to grow. After one of the Passovers, Mary and Joseph, they traveled back towards Nazareth from Jerusalem in probably what was a large caravan and people, because after a few days' travel, they realized that Jesus wasn't with the caravan. And so they traveled back to Jerusalem on their own, and after 3 days, it says in Luke, after 3 days, they found him. Imagine how worried they would have been after their 12-year-old child's not with them. And they found him in the temple amongst the teachers listening to them and asking questions. I imagine Mary and Joseph were pretty upset. And Jesus responds to them. It's found in Luke 2:49 through 52. "Why were you searching me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then they went down to Nazareth with him, and he was obedient to them. But his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. And so here we have the four, balanced parts of a balanced life. Jesus grew in wisdom intellectually. He grew in wisdom. He grew in stature. He grew physically, growing stronger as we need to grow. And in favor with God is your spiritual growth. That's the part that's often neglected in our lives, and many times neglected in our homes. We can't just leave it up to other people teaching our kids. We need to teach them spiritually things too. And then he grew with man. He grew socially. And so these are important things. You have the four main elements mankind needs to grow for a balanced life. Much of this growth happened the same way so much growth happens for us today within the confines of a loving family. I think for a moment all the things you know because of your family. Not because of the schools, but because of your family. A group of kids was asked what they learned from their family, and there was some of the things that they said here that was recorded. They learned it's not about me, it's about other people I need to love. They learned they always teach me the homework and how to do it. They always taught me a lot of math. I learned Spanish in my home. They taught me how to read and write. That happened in the home too. They taught me to never run away at the mall, to not say bad words. Like if my brother gets mad, to not get mad and get back at him. To not talk to strangers. To be kind. And if you don't be kind, you won't get many friends. God's love never stops. Don't copy the behaviors of this world. Try to be teachable. My mom taught me to hula hoop. Even if it's hard to tell the truth, my dad always says manners make the man. They taught me a lesson about God. That family never gives up. That they're always there for you. Even when we go through hard times, always trust in God because he'll be there to help you get through it. How many things do you learn in the home that are so valuable, that are really helping learn even more than in the schools, and even helps the schools, the learning that happens at home, because the kids are more prepared and more behaved at school when they first learn in the home. Families are important for growing and learning. The foundational, most important lessons we learned at home. And here are the few lessons I want to cover for ongoing growth. Some of the things I wrote down that we learn that are so instrumental in the home that we learned: what to do with your feelings, how to handle your emotions. In a good, healthy, amazing family, you learn how to recognize and name your feelings, to acknowledge them, not run from them, so you can deal with them. You know it's never healthy to stuff your feelings down. It's not good to flippantly tell your kids, "Don't cry, stop crying, don't be a baby." Emotions are healthy. In a healthy family, you can talk honestly about feelings. You can see what they're based on. What's the cause? Can you give help or support for them? Certainly, sometimes a parent is seeing sort of a selfish fit being thrown. And if you diagnose that, you just need to help the child with some discipline or correction. Tell them, you can't just throw fits to get what you want. Certainly, there's a place for that. But to have open dialogue in the family about what's really going on, not suppressing the emotions, but talking about those in a healthy way. You also learn in a family how to handle conflict. You know, there's going to be problems in a kid's marriage and in a kid's job if they never learn how to deal with conflict. And where do you first learn to deal with conflict? In the homes. People in the homes teach you those skills. We need to learn how to get mad, but also deal with that anger in a responsible way, in a healthy way. Two ways you'll see most people gravitate in dealing with conflict is they either become a skunk or a turtle. You know, skunks, they just spray all over the place, and it stinks up the whole area, but everybody knows exactly where they stand, and they just kind of go off. And then there's people that are turtles that just kind of put their neck back in the shell. And those are the two main ways I see people deal with conflict, and neither one of them are really God's best way. And so in the home, when in handling conflict, we teach our kids not to be a skunk or a turtle, but in a responsible, articulate way to voice be assertive, but not overbearing, not harsh, how in handling conflict. And this is learned in the home. We learn how to handle loss. There's going to be loss. There's going to be big losses, small losses, ups and downs in life. There used to be a game we used to play with the kids called Chutes and Ladders. You climb up a ladder sometimes, but then you come down a chute and you're right back where you started from. And I like the game, and I remember playing with our kids sometimes. The first time they went down a chute, they almost cried. And I said, man, this is a good game because it teaches you about life. Because life is a constantly ups and downs, ladders and chutes, to where sometimes you thought you were getting ahead, but then you're way back down to the bottom. I think it was Coach K at Duke University a few years back. He lost early in the season to a team that they should have beat. And he said later he wanted to shake the other coach's hand and say thank you to him. Because his team had a lot of success. Even though they were freshmen, they had a lot of success in their past in high school. And they began to just believe if they just showed up, they would always win. And he wanted them to develop an attitude, what Christian counselors call resiliency. It's a biblical principle. It's about the ability to be shot down, but be able to come back up. It's a biblical principle found in Proverbs 24:16. It says, the godly man trips seven times, but they will get up again. But one disaster is enough to overthrow the wicked. To get knocked down, you get back up. You get knocked down, you get back up again. Why? Because we know what life's all about. We know the author of life. We learn in our families about what matters most, what should be valued. Do you know that the world's not teaching you all the same values that you would like them to learn and be taught? The world teaches our kids things like, man, it just only matters about what you look like. Character doesn't matter so much. It matters if you have lots of money. That's where you'll find the most fulfillment, and that's where you'll find the most significance. And we know those things aren't true, but we got to teach those to our kids. The world teaches that everything is about sex, and it's not. The world teaches us the more you get people to praise you, the more valuable that you are, and that's not true. Our kids are learning a lot of values from movies, video games, songs, from their friends, from the culture, and all these things aren't necessarily true. I think the good thing is that Satan, the enemy, tempts us over and over with about the same temptations. He's very predictable. Effective, but very predictive. Predictable. Philosophers call these things hedonism, materialism, and secularism. I like how one pastor phrased the temptations as sex, salary, and status. Regardless of what we call them, Satan uses them because he's been able to deceive people about what life's about over and over again with the same three or four temptations. We need to help our kids know how the enemy is going to come at them and prepare them for that. One pastor said, you know, every advertisement on TV is a product to appeal to one of these temptations, to where the pastor went as far as to shed light on putting the light on the world's values and showing them what they are and what they really amount to is by having, he paid these kids a dime for every time they could connect a commercial to one of those temptations. I said, here, that's what it's trying to get you to believe. Is that true? Is that correct? Well, no, Dad. Dad, I need an iPhone. Really? How did people live before them and with much greater mental health? It's not a need. Finally, our kids learn good habits at home for personal hygiene, respectful manners, how to address adults in your life, not to chew with your mouth full of food, with your mouth open. All things are picked up and learned at home. Obviously, much more good and important habits than just these are picked up at home, but I probably spent too much time on all we learn at home here, but too often I think your parents and grandparents don't know how valuable and influential and important you are to kids, even teenagers. A survey was done even by MTV, a very secular TV organization, but they asked kids who are the most influential and most admired people in your life, and the great majority of even teenagers picked one or both parents as the people in their life they looked up to the most, who had influenced them the most. Certainly there's other influences that are not as great, but the home still has the most prominent venue and opportunity to positively impact the lives of kids and thus determine the futures of our society. You parents and grandparents matter in your kids' lives. Keep on, don't give up. Keep on pouring into them. Keep on sharing with them. Keep on telling them the truth. How do we do this? How is this done? Well, I just wrote down some practical applications here. There's one, leading by example. John 13, 14 through 15, Jesus says this, "And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you." So Jesus just gives us an illustration how to pour into other people. Is one, do it by example. Jesus not only told the sermon, but he showed the sermon. He lived it out. They say that with kids up until age 12, things are taught. And then after age 12, things are caught. They just watch you. They're watching you and doing what you're doing. I think it's why Chuck Colson used to say the number one risk factor for kids to end up in prison is they have an adult parent that's in prison. They are watching what their parents are doing and doing the things their parents are doing. We need to be careful how we are leading them by our example. We can't have that old cliche, don't do what I say, do what I do. That is crazy. We lead by example. We also lead through conversation. I know those are some that think, well, talk is so cheap. What is conversation? What do words really mean? I would say, speak up and teach. Keep on teaching. Jesus and Mark said, I've come to preach. I wanted people to know what I'm all about, Jesus is thinking. If we don't teach our kids with words and by example that go with those words, the world will fill in plenty of information for them. And we know that garbage in, garbage out. So what kinds of input do you want going into your kids' lives to see what's going to come out of them? I would say to offer them words of life, the word of God, and to keep on pouring those every teachable moment, every opportunity to speak truth, to talk about verses from the Bible. Just this week, it's been the time of year to look at the health curriculum for eighth graders, and Katie's in an eighth grade health class she's starting out with, and there's lots there I've seen in the curriculum that offers a very worldly perspective that does not lead to life. I think we ought to be involved in our kids' lives and find out what's being taught to them. We're getting involved as parents and saying, you know, some of this class Katie's not going to attend. We've already have these kinds of discussions at home, and we are approaching it from a biblical perspective. We just told the teachers that. We're going to approach Katie's education with a biblical perspective that we feel is not as destructive as some of the things in this curriculum. Deuteronomy 6, 6 through 9 says, "These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates." You put up scripture verses around your house? As you pray over your family, is there plenty of plaques and signs? We love lots of decorations that Kelly has put around our home have scriptures on them. It's a good thing. It's a pour truth into your life any way and every way you can to your kids. Third way is to avoid just being critical. As father, parents, my desire, you know, as a father and parent, my desire for my kids is to be their biggest fan. My heart moves from the direction from that, so I'm So they know that I'm rooting for them. They know that I care about them. They know I'm pulling for them. I'm their coach in many things and want them to win in life, so that when I have to come down on them, when I have to make a correction, I'm more than just a nag. I'm more than just a person that's yelling at them, or, you know, to where I see parents sometimes that just yell at their kids, or they come across strong so quickly, and they haven't built the relationship up where they've had lots of positive experiences, that the kids begin to just kind of just blow off mom or dad. It's like, hey, I can't please them. It'll never be enough. Dad will never think that he's proud of me, that he's pleased. And so we need to discipline with that perfect marriage of love and affection wrapped together in instruction and correction. But it needs to be married together, the affection and love wrapped up with correction and guidance. Ephesians 6:4 says, "Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger by the way you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and instruction that comes from the Lord." Not provoked, not to exhaust, not to exasperate, not to have them give up because they're never going to be enough. But it does say to instruct them in the Lord, bring them up in encouragement of the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Fourth and last way is to avoid comparing kids. Anytime you compare a person to another, a bad mistake has been made, because they're not the same person, nor they should be. You know, someone once said, if you and me are exactly the same, one of us doesn't need to exist. God made us all different, with all different gifts, different personalities, different characters. And you would never or never want to, you know, you hurt your marriage to compare your spouse to someone else, or never to say, well, you're just like your mom, or you're just like your dad. Not many people just to always enjoy that saying where there's some comparison. And so why would you say, why can't you just be more like your brother? Why can't you just be more like your sister? It should never be said. Never compare. Galatians 6:4 says, each one should test their own actions. Then they can take pride in themselves alone without comparing themselves to someone else. We need to allow the people in our lives just to be themselves and be proud of that. Whatever that is, to celebrate their uniqueness and their giftedness and how God has made them, and draw that out in them, encourage them. The invitation this morning also involves this. As wonderful as family can be, Russell Moore says in his book that I recently read, it's important never to engage in family worship. I don't mean to say be in worship together as a family. I mean where you get to the point where Americans many times has is where the number one value is family. The number one thing in life is family. Family above all else. Family this, family that. We're not to worship family. Jesus is the only one ever to be worshiped. And families are from God, but they are not God. Only one saves. Only one really brings fulfillment. Only one will never let us down, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when he's in our life, our families will go better, can go better, have the possibility of going better. Matthew 19:29 says, "And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother for wife or children or fields for my sake will receive 100 times as much and will inherit eternal life." Jesus is saying, man, I'm even more important than family. He's the number one intimacy and relationship that we should have, even more than our families. When I think of how important family is to me, it makes me respect all the more the faiths of those people in Islamic countries who decide to follow Jesus, and their families look at them and say, "You are dead to me." And they still choose to follow Jesus, and they pray for their families to come to know Jesus. Those people have my respect and admiration, because they know, as important as family is, there's something that's more important. And it's more important is because Jesus is the only one that loves us, how we truly need to be loved and cared for and be our Heavenly Father. And so this time we're going to celebrate that fact with our time.